Renegade Health Radio.
Renegade Health Radio. This is Frederick Patnod and Kevin Gianni. Kevin.
Frederick.
How are you today?
I'm awesome.
All right. That's live awesome, right? That's still the slogan.
Live awesome. Yeah, I'm really excited over here because I've got this whole new sound studio set up.
So I think for the first time, you're going to sound better than me.
This time the audio is going to sound good. We've been listening to you guys, and I have sound panels behind me. I have this fancy microphone. I had a sound guy set it up. So if it doesn't sound good, then he's the one that we need to blame.
All right. I want to talk today a little bit about the blue zones. You know, you talked about the blue zones in your book, Kev, Kale and Coffee. And the blue zones has always been an interesting concept for me. For those who don't know, those are the places where people live the longest, but where it's verifiable, not like the Hunzas in Pakistan that apparently claim to have lived like 120 years, but there are no records. So it was just hearsay. Oh, this guy, yes, he's 120 years old, but we can't tell for sure how old he is. So,
but look at him. He's really freaking old.
He's really old and he knows the secret. So the blue zones are places in the world where people live the longest. So they found five, and Dan Buettner wrote the book, and he's a National Geographic adventurer and journalist. So he went to all these places, and I recently attended a talk of his at the McDougall Advanced Study Weekend. And it was a great talk because he summarized his findings from the book, but also talked about where this is all going, where the research is going with longevity. And finally, he's putting together, along with other people, a big project of creating blue zones. And the biggest blue zone that they're going to create eventually is going to be the entire state of Hawaii. Apparently, that's what they want to do.
Wait a minute. You told me there was just a small one.
Yeah, but there's a bigger project. It's sort of like you start small and you go big. So the idea is all those long-lived people didn't try to live a long time. Like longevity just happened to them. You know, for the most part, they were not saying to themselves, I'm going to do this and live a long time. It just happened. And why? Because they lived in the right environment where the culture was conducive to longevity, but also health, like living the last years of your life healthy, not disabled or sick and in pain. So they found out what are those factors, but they think that you can't change individuals. You can't just summarize this information like we could summarize it right now and, you know, go into all the different things that you could do to increase your longevity from the blue zones, but most likely you're not going to do most of it because your environment works against you. So, you know, when you go out, you have to drive to go somewhere because that's the way your city is set up. There's no incentive to walk, except if you live in Berkeley or Montreal. but most of the U.S., it's not like that. So, and also other things. You go to the grocery store, you have unhealthy foods. You can end up lonely and not have any friends later in life if you're not actively seeking out friends and relationships because the culture works against you. The culture is a culture where it's easy to get fat, it's easy to get lonely, and it's easy to die young and of disease. So what they're doing is they're starting with a small city in Minnesota, and they wanted to get everybody involved, like the mayor, everybody on board, to create a blue zone. So they're changing the environment. They're building a running track along a lake, and they're creating potlucks. We're taking a lesson from the Seventh-day Adventists so that people can get together and every Saturday have a potluck together and get to meet others. So you can sign up for those, and it's a citywide thing. So what they found is after several years of monitoring this new blue zone, that people are actually living longer. They can, based on their health markers, they can already tell that they've increased their lifespan by 3 years.
Gotcha.
So they can tell that this is having, you know, an impact. So they want to use that experience that it will take years to develop because we humans live a long time, relatively speaking, and then extend it to other places, starting with small cities in small communities in Hawaii, and then eventually to the whole state of Hawaii and then other places as well. So I thought it was really interesting because, you know, I think it's an interesting idea that the culture where we live works against us or for us. And in this case, for example, the first blue zone is in Sardinia. And this is where the culture is very family oriented. And like in Okinawa also, people meet a few people when they're young. And this becomes their committed circle. So you're 5 years old or 3 years old, and you meet other five-year-olds, and you're introduced to them by your family members, and they're going to tell you these people are going to be your lifelong friends. And indeed, they become that you're supposed to travel with them, and you end up being close to them all your life. So this particular aspect of their culture makes sure that people are together. And it's just the way it is. It just sort of like how the culture developed, and our culture, the Western culture, we could say, has developed in a different direction, you know, which has good aspects and bad aspects, and certainly good for material wealth and all kinds of things. But it doesn't seem to be leading us to longevity, because the U.S. is pretty low on the list of Western countries in terms of longevity and health.
So how many people are in this city? I mean, is it like
20,000.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I was thinking there's like 100 to 150 maybe, or maybe even 50. Cause I mean, how do you encourage everyone to participate in something like this? I mean, I can't even get my family members sometimes to even just listen to me about certain things that are really, really, really basic. But that's amazing. I mean, think about the impact of this on a community and what it can actually do. It's so powerful if you can get a community involved to do this. I mean, it's similar to like the Jamie Oliver stuff when, you know, he went into a town and set up that whole kitchen and a community center. You know, my biggest question is how do you account for, one, the isolation factor of the blue zone. So each blue zone is isolated in a certain way. You know, some of them are geographic. And then Loma Linda, which is the Seventh-day Adventist, is almost like religiously isolated, because, you know, they're a community that has the same religion. It's not isolation per se, but, you know, they're inward facing almost, right? So for me, my question is how do you incorporate that into a blue zone? I mean, a fake blue zone or a created blue zone where, you know, people are going to work outside of town. They're coming back in, you know, they're doing things that are not necessarily what you would do within a blue zone. And the fact that people just don't like their jobs, you know, and maybe people in Sardinia and the Nicoya Peninsula don't like their jobs either. But I mean, they work, well, at least before, I don't know what is happening now, but I mean, they work to survive. It's a different kind of perspective. So it's not like I can go do something better. It's just like, this is what I've done, and this is what generations of my family have done. I'm going to continue to do that. And yes, I might be able to go off to university somewhere and then maybe may or may not come back. But here, opportunity is, even if it's not there, it's still in the back of someone's head. And to me, that seems like it would negatively impact you know, like a full-on blue zone thing. But at the same time, I mean, just the fact that health markers would drop if people have access to only certain foods, if they have more access to exercise. I mean, I think it's genius. I would love to see how they can do it in Hawaii, because Hawaii is the perfect situation of that isolation.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's why they're choosing small towns instead of bigger places. I mean, I have a hard time imagining this working out in a big city, because, I mean, a big city is constituted of smaller communities and neighborhoods and so on, and not everybody feel like they belong to that city. They just got there, and then, but in a small town, people know each other more, and there's already that sense of community. So that's why. I mean, most likely not everybody is going to participate 100%. But if you can get a lot of people to participate, you know, you can make an impact. There's also another kind of little anecdote I want to tell it was told at the conference by two or three different speakers, and I didn't know about this particular fact. So in Finland in the early 70s, something crazy started to happen. People were dropping dead in their 40s, like men in their 40s would be walking and ask other men, you know, have you had your first heart attack yet? I mean, it was just like rampant heart disease. So they had to do something. And they started in North Karelia. So this is a region of Finland. And they initiated this public they initiated this project of getting people healthy as best as they could. So people were smoking, they were eating, you know, 10 to 15 tablespoons of butter a day. I mean, they were developing heart disease very quickly. So what they did is they replaced the butter with vegetable oil. And some people criticized that particular part of the study in, you know, when I put this in my summary of the conference. But the idea is, you know, you had to make a change, like, you know, maybe vegetable oil is not that great, but it still probably leads to fewer heart attacks than 15 tablespoons of butter a day. So, and then, you know, smoking and so on. So they changed the community, and in, and they managed to drop heart disease rates by 85%. So, you know, they had to make changes in the habits of people by kind of forcing them a little bit to change. So kind of like what people are doing now with smoking, what the countries are doing with smoking, or they're making it more difficult for people to smoke. And there's more education about it. And there's, you know, it's becoming more difficult to purchase cigarettes, and they're becoming more expensive and taxed and so on. So it's, well, we can tell it's working to some degree. We don't know what aspects of all of those things are working in our favor, but as a whole, people are smoking less. So I think it shows that you can probably change a society, but education, I mean, we're kind of preaching to the choir, you know, I think with this podcast and other books that are being published. I mean, do you feel sometimes like that the majority of Americans are not really going to change anytime soon?
I mean, I don't know. It usually just takes someone. It usually takes a scare, and then someone that they like or trust to point them in the right direction. So most people, yes, they aren't going to change like right off the bat. Like, you know, just like, oh my gosh, I read something online and now I'm just going to go do it. But there are a lot of people who are starting to have these scares more and more so because, you know, disease onset is happening sooner and sooner in someone's lifetime. And luckily there are people out there who have this type of information. So I think that more people will get turned on to this sort of thing, which is of course a great thing, you know? So, you know, one thing I wanted to point out too is I like the idea of switching out something. So like they switch butter from butter to vegetable oil. I like the idea of like switching that out as a community. I think that's a kind of an awesome thing. I know, you know, everyone knows that I used to smoke cigarettes way back when. You know, I've publicly stated that when I was in high school and college. And I mean, a pack of cigarettes for me at that time, maybe it was like $1.50. And I know there are people listening who's like $1.50. I mean, that was expensive when I used to smoke cigarettes, but you know, whatever. Now, I mean, the cigarette tax is crazy high. I don't even know how much a pack of cigarettes costs. I mean, imagine it's $6, $7, $8, $9, $10, depending on where you're from. And that obviously does create an economic, you know, it becomes impossible economically for some people, which I think is good. And then Berkeley here, Berkeley, California, is one of the first, if not the first city to actually successfully pass a soda tax. And I've been following up on that and it seems to be very effective. And I forget for how many ounces of soda, you know, what the tax is, but you know, each place here within the, you know, whoever sells soda, they have to charge this soda tax. And then the government, the city government comes around and collects it. And the only people who were fighting this, by the way, was the soda lobby. And the soda lobby brought in a lot of money to Berkeley. I mean, foolishly. I mean, what were they thinking? They might be better suited in another city. But they brought in a lot of money to have advocates, you know, and even paid people to speak inside of the community, gave money for people in the community to speak positive, or not necessarily positively, because they don't really speak positively about soda, but like to speak about choice. And to speak about, you know, you can have a couple and it's okay, like that sort of thing. And it just fell flat here. And so the, you know, the community here voted to have the soda tax and it's pulling in money. I think it's pulling in like millions of dollars, which is pretty cool for the city.
I've always been a little reluctant about those taxes, mostly because, you know, I'm afraid somebody will decide that a food I think is healthy is unhealthy. Like someone might say, you guys eat too much fruit. We're going to tax for, no, I know they're not going to tax fruit, but no, they might tax whatever. I mean, there's so much debate in the health world that, I mean, I think there's a few things we can agree upon, like soda, but, it might make sense to tax the larger sizes because that's what people are buying. I mean, soda bottles used to be very small, like tiny compared to what they are today. And maybe the tax should be anything above that, you know, previous small amount that people used to drink should be taxed highly because, I mean, is there any justification to buy a 2-liter, you know, container of Coke? Maybe if you're having a party and that's what you want to serve. But I mean, yeah, do you think the taxes will be effective? I know that they tried to have a similar fat tax. I think it was in Denmark, if I'm not mistaken, a year or two ago, and they had to pull it back because of public outrage.
I mean, first off, I want to know, was it really public outrage? Or was it, you know, media and industry and that sort of thing? That would be the first question that I want to have. But here, I mean, it's taxed per ounce, so it does get higher as you... You know, there's more cost as you say you buy a, you know, an 8 ounce or, you know, a 24 ounce or a 64 ounce or something like that. So you will be paying more. I mean, I think that everyone, at least in the health area, can agree, like, look, soda's not a health giving sort of food. And I don't think it should go as far as like Kraft macaroni and cheese. Or, I don't know, Twinkies is a bad example, but I don't think it should go as far as in like canned foods or anything like that. I think that those need to remain untaxed, but candy, soda, cigarettes, you know, things like that, and alcohol, which is already taxed, marijuana, which, you know, when it's legalized throughout the country, that'll be taxed as well. It's already taxed in Colorado and Washington. I think that those things are... It should be taxed.
Let's not forget that a lot of foods are subsidized too. I mean, there are subsidies for meat and dairy products.
Very true.
That make it cheaper than it would be normally if people paid the true value, you know, because I mean, I think we can all say that people eat too much dairy and too much meat in the U.S. and Canada, and especially dairy products. Cheese in the U.S. is kind of... consumption of cheese is out of control. And maybe part of it is because it's so cheap. I mean, it's subsidized.
Yeah. And so that brings up an interesting point, a great point, because it could go in two directions or in two simultaneously similar directions, where you tax some of the things that, like the sodas and that sort of stuff, and then you realign the subsidies. So no longer are, you know, just corn products and wheat products and beef and dairy being subsidized, but you take subsidies off of those and then maybe even add some subsidies into encouraging farmers to grow other things like lettuce, tomatoes, you know, things that are definitely something that we probably should eat more of. Make those cheaper and then make the other foods like real price.
It's true. Calories are cheaper from unhealthy foods than from healthy foods for the most part, if you look at fruits and vegetables are very expensive. I mean, by any standards, it's more expensive to eat a lot of fruits and vegetables than it is to eat a lot of white bread and cheese.
When Emery were in the RV, we spent a lot of time at Walmart's because we park the RV in the Walmart parking lots. You can do that. That's a thing. I don't know if you can still do it, but it's a thing. Like Walmart encourages, you know, people who travel in RVs, if you don't have an overnight, you can stay there in their parking lot as long as there's room and as long as it's not snowing and they need the snowplows, because then they'll knock on your door at 3 o'clock in the morning. But with what we noticed there, you know, we'd go inside maybe to get water or to go to the bathroom sometimes. And there was one time, I think we were in Pittsburgh, outside of Pittsburgh, and there were two huge pallets in the front of the store as you walked in, and there were big signs over the top of them. And one was Kraft macaroni and cheese. That's probably why I brought it up, because I was thinking about that. One was Kraft macaroni and cheese, and the other one was, I don't know if it was like Cheez-Its or something like that. And it literally was $1 per box for each one. And I said to Anne-Marie, this is when it finally like hit me, you know, because again, you're not in a situation until you're in a situation. And if you're not in a situation until you are around other people who might be in a situation, then you start to realize what it's like. And I said to Anne-Marie, I said, you know what? If I didn't have a lot of money, if I didn't, you know, if I couldn't, you know, scrape up enough money to buy food, I mean, what would I buy? And the truth is, you know, particularly to feed kids, you know, we didn't have kids at the time, but now I get it. I mean, if I had to buy Kraft mac and cheese for our family to survive, then yes, I might actually do that because it's $1 and I can get like, you know, 30 boxes for my $30 instead of buying, you know, a couple bags of, you know, peaches or something like that. So per cost per calorie is definitely something that people think about, whether they think about it consciously or not, they definitely do. And it's a challenge because how are you going to convince someone who only has $30 to spend for food for the month, or maybe for 2 weeks, that, you know, it's really great to get vegetables? And yes, of course, you can say, all right, well, yeah, they should just grow them. But yeah, what if they're working two jobs and just to try to scrape the money together? I mean, you know, you have to get out of that perspective of like, oh, well, you know, that, you know, someone can always do it. And yes, someone can, but if they don't know any better, then they're going to go for that. You're going to go for that.
And they, I mean, people can eat for very cheap, a very healthy diet. If you know what to do, if you know what to buy. I mean, you can buy a 10-pound bag of potatoes for $1.50, and that if you don't boil, you know, if you don't fry them, and if you eat them whole, and rice and beans are very cheap. I mean, you can create a diet that's going to be very healthy for cheap. But you know, people go for the fast foods and the macaroni and cheese boxes and things, and also the vegetables, like the fancy vegetables, like the lettuce and so on, like the vegetables we don't eat for the calories, but we eat for the nutrients. Those are expensive by any standard. So, I mean, that's the only thing I hate more taxes in general if they're not utilized properly, but. You're absolutely right. I mean, increase the price of unhealthy foods and then decrease the price of healthy foods. I mean, I think that might not be enough, though, because people are, I think, are physically addicted to certain foods, and there's too much of an incentive, you know, the pleasure trap of sugar, fat, oil, sugar, fat, salt in those foods too, and they're engineered that way to taste good and to be addictive. So people might still buy, you know, they might still. Like your prisoners find a way to smoke cigarettes in prison. I mean, you know, obviously cigarettes are not for sale in a prison officially, but you do find a way. I'm sure they, you know, you don't smoke as much though.
Well, the other thing too is that some of the poorest people that we're talking about, there actually is no grocery store where they are. You know, West Oakland is a perfect example, at least until recently. West Oakland is maybe 3 miles from here, 4 miles from here. We're in Berkeley, like the farm-to-table food mecca of the world, maybe. But in West Oakland, there wasn't even a grocery store. Now there's 2 food co-ops, and then they're building like a full-on grocery store. And that just didn't exist. So, I mean, when you walked into the liquor stores, which is where the food was, you know, what would you have? You would have just like, you know, packaged macaroni and cheese and things like that. And so that's where people are buying some of their food from.
There's a really cool initiative in Montreal. It's a sort of like a vegetable box. Like every week you get a vegetable box, and people do that for organic food and some, but what they're doing is really making fruits and vegetables super affordable. So you sign up for one of those things and you get a box of fruits and vegetables, and they're not going to be organic, but they're fruits and vegetables, and it's like $7, you know, for a box.
That's a great deal.
And then you get an amazing amount of vegetables that for people that might not be able to afford them, and so volunteers put in time to contribute to this project, which makes it possible because they're basically giving them away at cost or below cost.
It's awesome.
By the way, the fat tax in Denmark was on butter, milk, cheese, pizza, meat, oil, and processed food if the item contained more than 2.3% saturated fat. And then people started going, you know, across the border to trade and get, and essentially it didn't work, and it was a bureaucratic nightmare. And
I get it. I mean, if it's on all of those things, yeah, I get why people went up.
It's not going to work.
It's not going to work.
I'd like to add quickly before we finish the 7 factors of the longest lived people in the world. Do you think that might be interesting?
Yeah, that'd be great, because I was trying to write them down before by memory.
Okay, so, well, let's see how many you can get right then.
Isolation?
Okay, no, that's not...
That's not on one.
No, that's not on there, no.
Okay. Family, community?
Yes, connect, you know, putting your loved one first. Yeah, exactly, having the community in place. And also, another factor relating to that is they found people belonging to faith-based communities, like churches, and going 4 times a month, that increases lifespan. And, you know, they think it might be the community aspect or something else.
Hmm. Like food, right? So no processed foods.
Yeah, so they found that the centenarians ate mostly a plant-based diet. And yeah, so that's what they had in common, and very little processed food.
All right, shoot with the rest. Go with the rest.
All right, so we have they move naturally, so no gyms were necessary, but they were kind of nudged into movement every 20 minutes, always doing a little something. So doing something throughout the year every day was better than being sedentary for a few months and then working hard for the summer like farmers did. They had the right outlook, so they had daily rituals to reverse worry. They took naps, and they had a sense of purpose, and there was no word for retire in their culture. So in most places, the word didn't even exist.
I had that.
There's one that everybody most people might be happy to hear, is that drinking a little bit apparently is good. So drinking a little bit of wine increased longevity. And then that's what they had in common. And then hanging out with the right tribe. So it's, again, a lot of these things are not about food. And the tribe is is the people around you. So if the people around you are healthy and moving, then you're going to be healthy and moving. Because if your three best friends are obese and unhealthy, there's a 50% chance you'll become obese and unhealthy because you become the people you hang out with. So those were the seven factors: moving, right outlook, drinking a little bit, plant-based diet, connect, faith-based community, and hanging out with the right tribe.
Sounds awesome.